So what I'm going to go over with you guys tonight is a very basic introduction to some techniques that you may or may not have seen or know of for working with metal relating to radio and electronics. So we'll talk about basic tools, how to use them, a method for simplified layout, cutting, bending, and shaping, repairs and modifications, and safety. So why am I doing this? I worked, later ran the maintenance shop of vocational school for 22 years. A large part of my work was in metal fabrication, quite often in conjunction with electric and electronics. So a lot of what I did kind of revolved around this. And I would like to share some basic hints and tricks to simplify what is sometimes seen as a bit of a black art. That is, it's just not something people talk about or know about. So there are basic tools. Let's see, how long was this? Oh, it was snagged on the wheel. Okay, so some of the basic tools, the real basic stuff, you need a drill. You can use something just as simple as a C-clamp, although I recommend using a vise. You need a square, center punch, hammer, basic pair of tin snips, and a good set of drill bits. When you work with metal, cheap drill bits really don't cut it, literally, for long. So a better set of bits is generally recommended. There are some more advanced tools that make your life a lot easier and your work a lot neater, and we'll go over that too. The most important tool are the safety glasses. Okay, 22 years in a school, I can tell you point blank that this is very important, especially with metal. I've had metal in my eye twice, and I was wearing glasses when that happened, so it can happen. I had a bandsaw throw a piece of metal, hit me here, bounced off the lens and into my eye, but because I had the glasses on, it bounced off and it didn't do any real damage. So always remember that you can't do much else if you can't see. Choosing the metal and the materials, aluminum, that's the stuff on the left here, is softer. Steel is harder. It tends to be cheaper and it's more available, but it's harder to work with. But it has its advantages also. Aluminum is soft. It bends easily when you're trying to work on it. Those are both prefabricated chassis boxes, which are readily available. They're not too expensive. And the first thing I want to talk about is a little simplified method of doing layout, right? So usually when you do layout, you would draw on the metal you're going to work with, or draw it on a piece of paper. And I like to use graph paper because I didn't have a piece for this, but graph paper is nice because it's already gridded out. So you can draw on the graph paper and not have to really measure point to point, because you can use the intersections of the lines as your points and then work from there, and it simplifies things. And you use regular paper, and I'm sure today a lot of guys are good with the computer. You could do CAD and print it out on your printer, right? And then you have it on paper. So then what I recommend is to get a piece of carbon paper, manifold paper. Remember typing on manifold copies and stuff? You can still get it. We used to use master units at the school from the old spirit duplicators, similar stuff. You take a piece of carbon, you lay your template, you lay your drawing on top of the carbon, you put the carbon on top of the chassis, and then what you could do is you take either a ballpoint pen. This is a ball stylus. They used to use these for cutting mimeograph stencils, but they're great for impressing on the carbon. You can use a ballpoint pen, and you run it along your lines, and then what you get, this is a chassis box. There's your perfect transfer through the carbon right onto the box. Now, the caveat here is it's a lot easier to do this on steel than aluminum. The carbon doesn't stick to the aluminum quite as well. If you rough it up a little, it sticks better. But it's a really quick way. Draw it on the either on your computer, on a graph paper, or regular paper. Lay it over and just run your lines, and there you have it. The other thing that you can do is you can use a prick punch. Now, we'll get into that in a minute. You draw it on regular paper, lay it over, and then you mark your holes through your template with what's called a prick punch. Now, once you've done that, you're going to center punch, which is a pointed punch. And you take, there's two styles. There's the standard center punch is just a steel punch, and you strike it with a hammer. And then there's a really fancy one that's got a spring in it.
And you just set it on the site and you
press it, and it has an impact device in it, right? Marks the point. It's a little extravagant. You don't need that. Now, center punches, here we go. My slide. Okay. So, a few words about center punches and prick punches. I used to get a real laugh out of this when I talked about this at the school. I don't ever understood why. The center punch is a very blunt, very short, shallow angle punch with a sturdy tip. And it's used for impressing a hole, a small dimple, into a piece of metal to center your twist drill when you're ready to drill. The prick punch is a very pointed, sharp punch with a very delicate tip, and it's used for on paper patterns. You use that to punch through the pattern and make your mark on the surface. Now, it's a great tool. Don't use it as a center punch, because once you do that, you start to blunt the sharp, fragile tip, and it's not going to really do its job anymore. So that's just a little tip about it. You don't need a prick punch. They're just great if you've got a template, you make a nice, clear mark through it. So we'll talk about cutting sheet metal. Now that can be challenging, but with some basic tools, the process can be simplified with better results. Everybody thinks of hacksaws when you talk about cutting metal. They really don't work well on sheet metal because gauge metal is thin and it fits between the teeth of the hacksaw. A little piece of metalworking theory is that when you're cutting with a saw blade, you generally, the rule of thumb is you want 2 to 3 teeth of the saw blade supported by the edge of the metal, meaning the thickness of the metal versus the number of teeth per inch on your saw blade are relative. If you try to use a hacksaw, a standard hacksaw, on sheet metal, it's just going to sit, the teeth will just sit on the metal and you won't get a clean cut. So we use tin snips, aviation shears. These are the most common tools that we use for cutting sheet metal. Nibbling tools and power shears, sometimes they used to call them Ket cutters, that was the company that came out with them, and big bench and stomp shears are progressively more expensive, that can speed work and give you even cleaner results. So this here is what we generally refer to as a set of aviation shears. They are improved sheet metal shears. The old sheet metal shears basically look like a big pair of scissors. These are a compound tool. It has a compound leverage device. If you're looking to buy a set, the only ones that I would recommend are the Metal Masters, but they're a little expensive. You know, there's other stuff out there today that's cheaper, and for if you're not using it a lot, they'll work. That happens to be a right-handed shear. They come straight, right-handed, and left-handed, and that's to get into different areas. Usually, you have a set of them. They work really well, but it's difficult because they tend to distort the metal as you squeeze them. You got to be careful because when the metal is thin, you tend to bend and twist, and it's a bit challenging. This is a better way. And years ago, I would say this was somewhat untenable for someone who doesn't do this often. But nowadays, I see that our friends over in Red China have introduced much less expensive ones on the market that I assume would be pretty good if you're not using them every day. This is a power shear, and I brought one here, and I'll show you how it works. Basically, what it is a punch and a die with a motor, and it automatically, it runs, and you get a nice, clean cut, and it's almost like using a jigsaw, but it actually punches up and down, and it cuts the metal very cleanly, like butter, actually. It goes like a hot knife through butter, as they say. Now this is what is used, and I'm sorry that the bench it's on is a mess, but most of you guys can probably understand that. This is what you use when you're doing a lot of stuff. This is a small version of a commercial shear. It's a bench shear. And that makes a perfectly straight, clean edge. And you have your squaring edge over here. And you feed the metal in. And you pull the handle down and get a nice, clean cut. But again, that's extravagant. And you don't need that. I'm just putting it there so you see how this is done in the commercial environment. So then we talk about bending metal, right? Now, again, the best way to bend metal is on either a bar folder or a box break, the difference, or finger break. The difference being box breaks and finger breaks have relief grooves in them and fingers you can adjust so that you can, if the piece you're bending has an edge that's already bent, you can relieve it and it doesn't hit the break. But I'll show you one. I brought one here, you can see. But you don't need that. A bench vise and a hammer can produce surprisingly good results. And if you need something longer, you can take two C-clamps and a strip of steel on the edge of a bench, clamp your metal, and then you can, again, use the hammer and bend a straight line. You can bend it using pliers, but that seldom produces clean results, and you generally can't get a straight bend over a long distance, a long piece of metal. So here's a example of using a hammer and a vise to bend the metal. So you put your metal and you square it to the jaw of the vise, and then you strike it with the hammer and you progressively move back and forth across, and you can get a nice clean bend using the jaw of the vise as a guide, and it works well. The trouble is, because the vise jaw is only so wide, you're limited as to how much you can do with that, although you can move it back and forth, but again, then you start to get distortion where you've moved it in the jaw of the vise. So this is a small benchtop break, it has the jaw and it has the movable bar, and then you fold, you put the handle in there, and this, you bend it up, and that's the result when you used the brake. That one, they used to sell those years ago.
But I think there's a copy of
that. That also comes from Harbor Freight now. It's almost like, it's just a, you know, like a ripped off design, and they're not that expensive. So now we'll get into making holes. So sometimes making large holes, or those that are not round, can be one of the most challenging tasks for the amateur chassis builder. There are several methods, and we're going to go into a few of those, going from holes below a half inch all the way up to holes big enough for a 12-inch speaker. Just remember, with holes, they all start small and round, and then you make them whatever shape you want or make them bigger. And that even goes with drill bits. So before any hole is made, if you're working with metal, you have to use a center punch. And the purpose of using the center punch is because you want to make that little indentation in the metal. Because if you don't, what you're going to find is that your drill bit is going to, your push drill is going to want to walk, right? Even if you're using a drill press, your twist drill is going to want to walk. Especially a small bit will start to bend as it starts in the hole. Having the little center punch dimple there will allow the cutting tip of the drill bit to rest in that hole and not walk, and you'll get your hole accurately exactly where you want it. So that's the purpose of using the center punch. So this is something else that I stress, is that you always have to put your work in a vise or clamp it to a bench. Never hold it with your hand, especially sheet metal. It is sharp enough, and the motors on even these cordless drills are strong enough that they will take your finger off. So it's really imperative that you clamp it either with a C-clamp or in a vise. And by the way, I want to point out, this is a metalworking vise. It has tooth jaws to hold things well. But if you want to protect what you're working on, they sell these little non-marring jaws. These actually have rubber on the inside, a copper set. Those are made so that when you put something you want to look good in a vise, you don't wind up impressing the vise teeth into it. Those are magnetic. They go
right on the
vise jaws. But you don't need a fancy bench vise. Just a C-clamp will do. You clamp it to the top of a bench. And for what you're doing, it's quite safe. So
what I was starting
to say about holes starting small, if your final hole, for argument's sake, is going to be a half inch, don't take the half inch drill bit and start drilling the hole, because what you're going to wind up with is your arm twisted up like this and the metal bent and a whole lot of other one and a jagged hole. Start off with your quarter inch drill bit. Drill your quarter inch hole. Now move up to 3/8, then go to half inch, and you'll get a nice clean hole right where you want it without mangling the metal. And that's something, again, people don't talk about or realize, but it makes it so much cleaner and safer. Now, once we've gotten past the round holes or small holes, we can make larger holes for tube sockets or IF transformers, things of that nature. And the best way to do that is with something called a Greenlee punch. And there are other ones out there. These were from Walsco. There was a set Lafayette used to sell. It was made in Japan. And they really are actually decent. You know, if you're not using them every day, I've seen that those old Japanese sets work great. Basically, what the Greenlee punch is you have a receiving cup, you have the punch itself, which has the cutting edge, and you have the draw stud. And this is the resulting knockout that you get after you've used the Greenlee punch. So the way you use the Greenlee punch is you first drill the hole in the piece of work that is the proper size for the draw stud of the Greenlee punch that you're using, right? You can make it a little bigger, you know, but just know if you make it bigger, you might not be exactly on center. You have to pay attention to that when you use the punch. So you drill your hole for your draw stud, and then you assemble the punch, which comes apart. You put the punch on one side, the cup and the draw stud on the other, and then you put a wrench on the punch while holding the work. And the final result is a nice clean hole. Now, the Greenlee punches cut really clean holes, but sometimes with aluminum, because it's so soft, it'll, especially aluminum, will give you a bit of a burred edge. Okay, I'm using a deburring tool here, which has a little hardened steel cutter, and you drag it around the circle, and it really just deburs it nicely. But you can use a nice fine file, always a fine tooth finishing file with sheet metal, again, for the same reason as with a hacksaw, because you want the teeth close together or you're just going to chatter and tear the edge up. Another method of making small holes is with something which is, it's a hand punch, usually called a Whitney punch, because that was the company that made the majority of them forever. And really what it is a glorified hole punch, handheld hole punch. And you have a set of punches, right, and receivers here, and you change the punch can be changed.
I bought one
here if you want to take a look at it. And you basically open it up, you put it over the edge of the work, and there you go. It makes a nice clean hole, doesn't make a mess, and it punches a nice clean hole. Again, they're for sheet metal. And again, like everything else today, you can get an imported one rather inexpensively, and they're kind of handy to have. But you don't need that. You can use a drill, but that's just, if you're doing it, it's a quicker, cleaner way. And another method of making larger holes is with a hole saw. Now, that's a tool that's used for wood and metal. Now, when you buy them for metal, you have to get one, the hardened steel, or what they call bimetal teeth. Otherwise, it's, you know, the ones that are made just for wood are not going to go even through sheet metal. This one here happens to be designed specifically for sheet metal. It has the little carbide teeth, and it's specifically designed to cut sheet metal cleanly. You can use any metal cutting hole saw. It may come all the way up to like 3 inches. Right? And if you're real careful, you can use them, but they chatter a lot. You really got to clamp the material well. And they can tear up the edge of the hole a little bit, but they work well enough.
I mean, that's
one way to go about it, and they're a lot less expensive than the Greenlee punches. And then there are those very large holes, like for a 12-inch speaker or a 5-inch speaker or what have you. And this is a really neat tool to use for making big holes. And what it is, this is actually designed for and normally used in the HVAC trade for cutting ductwork where ducts intersect. And it has this little pin. It's sort of like a bar compass, right? Or a compass, or a beam compass, they used to say. So it has this pin, and it has this rotating drill bit in here, which is really more like a mill cutter. And what you do is you take this drill bit, and I have it here, you can take a look at it. You drill the hole in the material. You take that out, and this little piece has a barb on the end of it, and you pop it into the hole, and it holds itself in. And then you hold that in one hand, and you use the drill, and the tool cuts very well, and it goes around like a compass, and it makes a perfect round hole. And the best part is, these are not that expensive. I think they're less than $50, or they used to be. And they work so well, and they make such clean holes. And they make this that goes up to 20 inches. This one's a 12 inch, which is really all you're going to need for what you're doing, but they make them that are like up to 20 inches. That's a really handy, it's a radius cutter. And they've been around, they're not that old, they've only been around about 30 years, but really handy tool that makes really neat work. And then you have non-round holes. And again, you can use square and other shaped Greenlee punches that come in different shapes and sizes, but again, you'd be going and spending a lot of money for a specific punch, which might not really be that great a move. So that's where this nibbling tool comes in. And you can also use it to cut through metal, but what it does is you insert it into a round hole, and I have pieces here. You could try it. You'll see what it looks. You can actually, it has a square cutting die in there. It's a punch and die setup, and it basically works similar to a Greenlee punch, but you control it with your hand, and you squeeze it, and it punches and it cuts square edges. So you want to put a slide switch. You want to cut it an IF transformer. Or anything like that. These nibbling tools are wonderful. Now, what I will tell you is I use the word Adel because the Adel is the original manufacturer of those tools. They're still around. You can still get them. I think they're now up to about $55. The phone company was big with those. Klein Tools sold that tool. I'm sure it was made by Adel because I have one that's identical and it's just as well made. They used to sell them at Home Depot. I don't know if they still do. And maybe they were a little less, but they're in and around the $40 to $50 range. And they're well worth it because they make such nice cuts. There are cheaper ones. I had one from Radio Shack years ago. And again, it worked. It did the job. It wasn't it broke eventually, but I used it a lot. But you don't have to buy the best one, but once you've used it, it's hard to go back to the other type. So in closing, this is in no way a complete course on the construction of a radio chassis. It's simply just a how-to, some of the more common and troublesome things people run into. Always remember safety first. Metal is sharp. It can cut and give you splinters and wind up in eyes, and it's always wear eye protection. And remember, power tools have no friends. And that was what we used to tell the kids at the school. Power tools have no friends. So happy building. And I have some stuff here so I could show you. I have the nibbling tool here. I bought round and square Greenlee punches. There's the circle cutter. This is a Whitney punch, and this is a deburring kit. This is an edge deburr. You drag along the edge. This is a hole deburr. Again, unnecessary, but, you know, so you get to see what they look like. This is the power shear. If you want to see that work, we can try that out. And this is a sheet metal cutting hole saw. So, and this is the small break. So, does anybody have any questions, first of all? Yeah.
Just to make a clarification.
Yeah. Well, you actually, let me bring something, because there's something that I wanted to mention. Okay. When you talk about Greenlee punches, and Richard made me think of this.
These, the ones I have here right now,
were sold as, and are still sold as, radio chassis punches. And they come in fractional sizes, and
size
tube sockets, whatever you... And they still make all the Greenlee punches they made 50 years ago. They still make all the different sizes. The only thing that's changed is the price. They used to be $15. Now they're $60, $70, $80. You could find them, ham fests, state sales, things like that. Now, there are a lot of Greenlee punches around, and the most common ones are marketed to the electrical trade, and they come in conduit sizes, right? So it'll say half inch, but it's not a half inch hole. It's a sized for a half inch knockout hole for a half inch conduit, half inch ID conduit, right? 7/8 size, right? You can use, I use those for years, right? I have the whole set with the hydraulic pump in it. They're great. You just have to know, you got to measure them as 7/8, and you go, you get away with it because a lot of them are very close to an octal tube socket or whatever you're trying to punch. I did that for years, but just know when you buy them, if you're buying the electrical trade punches, they are not, if it says half inch, that's knockout size, which is three quarter, which I can't remember the, yeah, inch and a quarter. Yeah, so just know that, like a three quarter is perfect. If I remember right, an octal tube socket's about inch, and so it worked for that. So, but the ones that you would really be looking for are called radio chassis punches. And if you're looking at old ones, the other company that made decent ones was Walsco, and they called them Pioneer punches, and they did the same thing. I've seen other ones. Blackhawk made them. There's a few different companies, but again, there are radio chassis punches, and there are trade size punches. But you can use them. You just have to know what the nominal diameter is versus the size printed on the punch. Yeah.
Darren, I mean, if I see some of your sales, can you wear out Greenlee?
Yeah, you can. But honestly, if you look at the edge, you feel it with your finger.
Yeah.
If it feels crisp, if it looks clean like that, they're okay.
Okay.
More commonly, the drawsteads get busted on them, right? That's the biggest common failure, is the busted draw studs, because somebody trying to punch through something too thick, or because the punch is so dull that they're exerting so much force that the draw studs break. And you can buy new draw studs for them.
And the electrical industry, you don't use it by hand, you use
the hydraulic
punch.
Yeah.
And I have seen 3-inch punches go flying.
Yeah.
Yeah. They're dull, or they're off center on two pieces of metal, no cabinet, and they will just, you'll get hurt.
When I worked at the school, I wasn't watching, and I had somebody try to punch, I shouldn't say a kid, it was actually another staff member, tried to punch through a piece of diamond plate with a Greenlee punch. Now, he had seen me do that, but I did it to aluminum. So I figured out that the hydro worked fine with the aluminum, and they're even rated differently for the, but he didn't realize he did it with a piece of steel. And that punch, the end of that punch, and the draw stud broke on the hydro. It was the hydraulic, and just pumping it. Yeah, it went flying like a bullet. It actually bounced off a machine, and it made a clank when it bounced off the machine. But the hydraulic punches are fun, but they're a lot of money. You don't need that. But these work great. These work great. And if you want to try it out, I brought a wrench. I have some chassis with holes pre-drilled in them, so we can try it out and like that. So any other questions? Okay, yeah.
I noticed that while you were going over tips, you didn't really mention chalking anything with a piece of wood, so that, like, usually when I work on things, I tend to use wood to, like, clamp in between.
You can use wood as a backer if you're drilling a hole, depending on what you're trying to. Now, if you're trying to hold something in a vise, or on the edge of a bench, and it's sticking out real far, you use a piece of wood as a backer. We don't always need that, but the problem when you do that with sheet metal, sometimes the chips will cause the metal to get stuck to the wood, and then you'll try to bend it when you try to put, you know, you can use wood, but I depends what you're doing. It depends what you're doing, whether you need it or not. Sharp, the best thing I can recommend, if you're going to invest in good something, buy good drill bits, because I've had people call me up. I had a friend call me up. He was trying to do something with one of his trailers, and he said, I can't drill through this trailer. I don't understand. Can you come here and heat it with a torch so I can, it must be tempered. I said, they don't make trailers out of, they might be hard carbon, but they don't make trailers out of hardened steel.
Well, I can't
drill through it. So I go over there and I look at the drill bit he was using. I said, here, let's try another drill bit. And it went right through. So drill bits, if there's one area that things are not created equal, it's drill bits. I don't know why there's so many bad drill bits on. Well, I do know why, but yeah, bad drill bits. If you buy a cheap index of drills,
I recently
found out that there was a company that got caught making the bits in China, of course. And what drill bits do you use? Eighth inch, 1/16, quarter inch, 3/8, half inch, right, 3/8. And what they were doing is those bits would be high carbon, high speed steel. And then the other bits were garbage metal that they dipped in a phosphate bath to make them black, like they did with the high speed. And they filled in the indexes with this garbage that when you went to drill, they either untwisted if they caught, or they just dulled right out and didn't go through. So, you know, there's a lot of crappy drill bits floating around. Yeah.
Would it ever be helpful to warm up your material?
Not really. Not with sheet metal. It's not, no, I wouldn't. Especially not aluminum, because aluminum doesn't even have any color change, so you might just... You're not dealing with anything so hard that you need to warm it up. I mean, if you have hardened steel and you need to drill it, you have to take the temper out of it. Yeah, you anneal it, but to do that with sheet metal for anything we're doing here is not really. Yeah.
What about lubricating?
Again, drilling into sheet metal, it's not that critical. The one thing I would lubricate, if you're going to be using one, is the draw stud on the Greenlee punch. You put a couple of drops of oil on that. It'll make that a little easier and make your punch last longer. Yeah.
Eric, what kind of drill bits do you recommend?
What do I recommend? Milwaukee. I actually, we had some Milwaukee indexes that were decent. Yeah, they're not bad. They were okay. What do I recommend? I recommend Greenfield, Chicago Latrobe. There's a number of them. You're not going to find them in Home Depot, and you're going to pay.
Like Morse.
Excellent. Any of those? Anything? Illinois. Illinois Tool. Any of those that you would find in a commercial shop, but you're going to be paying over $100 for a decent index.
Is DeWalt
any good? What's that? I'm sorry.
In our shop here, we have Harbor Freight drill bits.
Yeah.
And will not cut anything.
Right. So yeah, well, that doesn't, yeah, that didn't, yeah. I wouldn't, yeah.
They polish them that way.
Darren, can they be sharpened good drill bits?
Yes. Yes, absolutely. And there's actually, I learned, my dad taught me to sharpen them by hand on a grinder. And I had to learn to do that. He made me, and I could still do that, but I can't come close to what the one on the market that I think is wonderful. I have one. It's called a Drill Doctor, and it's very well designed.
And it
has a little chuck that you put the bit in. It does it all for you. You set the depth, and you turn it, and it rotates. It's got a cam in there, and it rotates. Got a diamond wheel, and it does a wonderful job of sharpening drill bits. Yeah. You got to be careful. You don't want to heat them up too much when you grind them because you kill the temper on them. If they start to change color, you can sharpen drill bits. But getting back to where you can get a lot of the better metalworking tools reasonably, there's a company called MSC. I used to use them for years when I worked in the school. I ordered stuff from them. And that's the company that supplies professional shops. And you can buy the best. Oh, yeah. Yeah, they're huge now. Yeah, you can buy the Granger is another one. You can buy the best. In another good brand of drill bits that you find in good hardware stores are Hansen. Hansen, Ace is decent. Vermont American is decent. There's a store on Route 9 that sells professional hand tools, Epis. They have really good stuff in there. There used to be a place up on Route 22, Force Tool, but they went out of business. There's actually a place in Kenilworth. I can't remember the name of it. Right off the parkway. It's a professional, it's a commercial shop supply. Sells all the best stuff, and he's really reasonable because he buys a lot of surplus. So sometimes he'll give you a good deal. He'll put indexes of drills together and give you a really good deal. That's another thing. If you want good drill bits, there's a lot of surplus floating around. And Epstein Online used to be another one. A lot of these surplus places sometimes get good ones from the government because the government never bought cheap tools. All their stuff was pretty top shelf. Yeah.
The drill bits yourself, is it cobalt, titanium?
That is the coating on the bit. And it does help, but you know that's putting. There are very good TIN coated drill bits. They're like
gold colored,
right? Or cobalt coated, and that's good. But you got to do that to a good bit, because you know otherwise you're just, what do they say, putting lipstick on a pig. It doesn't really, you know, it still won't cut. Like you said, Jules, that the Harbor Freight bits aren't worth it. Or they aren't worth a damn. I've seen them. I've used them.
They're circular
Davis. Yeah, they're really. I mean, we had a guy brought a whole index of them
in the big box. Had,
you know, if you know drill bits, there's everything you'd be doing here is fractional size, but then you have your numbers and your letters, your tap drills and stuff like that. And they
just had everything in it.
And I went to use them, and we were drilling into, you know, heavy steel, not just sheet metal, and they just dulled right out. They didn't. Kind of useless, but I mean, now they've gotten a lot better with their stuff. I don't know about the drill bits, but I wouldn't recommend them. So,
is the Walt any good?
I've never used them. They have a good name, so I would think that their drill bits would be decent. Remember, if you're doing this stuff, Milwaukee or DeWalt bits are probably fine. You're not drilling into solid steel for 2 inches, you know, it's not
the same thing. But yeah, it's.
It's definitely a thought, you know, but you want to get good drill bits. Otherwise, you'll just frustrate yourself. No. Yeah.
Can't overemphasize the use for protection.
Oh, like I said, you know, in the school,
that was a big deal. And, you know, I was big on that. And even with the glasses,
I still
managed to get metal in my eye twice. Right. And once I
actually watched it come up,
I felt it hit my face. I watched it bounce off the inside of the lens, and I saw it come, and then I felt it in my eye, just like that, right off of a bandsaw. So it
absolutely
is, you know, you can't do anything if you can't see, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah. Anything else? Okay.
Thank you.